Our next speaker, Denise Stapley, she was a contestant on that awesome reality show Survivor, where everybody looks better than me, but whatever, I've never even auditioned, so I don't care. Anyway, Denise is here. Please come on over this way, Denise. She is going to talk with us the unexpected gifts of Survivor, and we are happy to have you. Welcome, and I've talked enough. You take a chair.
We'll start by lowering that down. Can everybody hear me okay? Wonderful. Well, again, good morning. My name is Denise Stapley, and I am truly so honored to be here, but I'll be really honest with you. I'm also a little bit terrified. But lucky for all of you, I brought my big girl panties with me, so I think we'll be okay. But over the last, about the last year, I've had the opportunity to speak with a variety of audiences about my Survivor experience. But this and what I'm going to be talking about today is a definite departure from that. So again, keep in mind that this gig was never part of the deal, but I'm extremely excited to be here. So that being said, I feel like I need to give you a few disclaimers before I get started today. So let's get started. For starters, I am most certainly not an amazing author. Nor do I believe that the one religious studies course that I took in college in any way, shape, or form makes me a religious scholar. And as much as I would like to be, I am most certainly not an awesomely outspoken advocate. So again, that being said, I imagine that there are at least a few of you out in the audience wondering, well, then, why exactly are you here? Well, good question. I'm truly here to do one thing, and one thing only, and that's simply to share with you my experience of faith in the game of Survivor. And along the way, in the process, I hope to share what I believe is a message of change, and how we can be impactful in what I would call a community of thinkers. As I do that, I hope that you'll remember a couple of things. One, at the core of it all, I'm just me. I'm just Denise Stapley. I'm just a mother, I'm just a wife, I'm just a therapist from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I'm truly nothing more than an ordinary person who had the opportunity to be a part of an incredible reality TV game. Here I am, just me and my little old stool. I see this stool, and for some of you this may not make sense, but I see that stool, and every time I see this slide, it just makes me smile. Because I see that, and that stool has come to represent for me one of the greatest experiences of my life. I see that, and I see 39 days, 15 tribal councils, hundreds of mosquito bites, and a whirlwind of experiences. Now, before we really get into the nuts and bolts of things today, I want to tell you just a little bit about how this Survivor journey got started in the first place. For years, my husband and I have been fans of the show. And just with a show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the show Survivor? Awesome. By chance, how many of you got a chance to see the season that I was on, which was season 25? Yay, awesome. Okay, fantastic. Well, just in case, for those of you who aren't familiar with Survivor, I'm going to give you the condensed version. Survivor is a very real reality show in which a group of complete strangers are stranded together, forced to create a world in which to live, we perform in challenges, and then one by one, we vote each other off the island. At the end of the day, the sole survivor wins some pretty nice bragging rights and a $1 million prize. Well, season after season, I would watch, and season after season, I would find myself yelling more and more at my TV because I simply wanted my chance. I wanted my chance to be there, wherever that might be. Every season, it was the same. I'd think about who I might have aligned with. I'd think about how I might have done a challenge. I'd think about who I would have connected with and why. And so finally, in the fall of 2011, at the ripe age of 40, I decided to dig deep for a little courage to apply for the second time for the show. Well, clearly, I had no idea how life-changing hitting that little submit button would be. And in the words of Mr. Jeff Probst himself, though, the adventure you're ready for is the one you'll get. So 1 week after I hit that submit button, I received my first casting call. I went through months of waiting, a week of finals in Los Angeles, until it was finally official that I'd made the cut to be a part of the cast of the 25th season of Survivor. Now, I knew it was going to be intense, and I knew it would be challenging, But quite honestly, I had no idea how life-changing or impacting this experience would be on so many different levels. It's been actually almost to the day, nearly 2 years since I arrived home from the Philippines. And as crazy as it's going to sound, I can tell you that I've thought about the game almost every single day since I've been home in the last 2 years. And I think about, what I think about are the relationships that I took away from it. I think about the experiences and what we went through as a group out there. And those reflections for me have come to be what I now call the unexpected gifts of survivor. Now, truly, I could talk for hours about how appreciation was taught to me through simple deprivation and disconnection from my family for a period of 7 weeks. Or we could talk about discomfort and determination that was again taught to me through 16 days of absolutely miserable and consistent rain. But that's really not what I'm here to talk about. What I'm here to talk about is the acceptance of the authentic self. We heard that word talked about in the opening remarks. And that's what I'm here to talk about again, is the acceptance of the authentic self and lasting relationships. But what do I mean by that? When I talk about acceptance of the authentic self or authenticity, this is what I found. When I've been pulling together these presentations, this is one of the definitions that I came up with that I just absolutely love. It says authenticity, it's to be true to one's own personality, spirit, or character. And I absolutely love that definition because it fits for not just the game, but for our lives. It's the idea that there is no edit. We are who we are. The traits in all of us, good or bad, just get, you know, intensified under extreme circumstances. It's the concept that wherever you go, there you are. You simply can't stop being you. Well, luckily, I'm pretty comfortable with my authentic self. Otherwise, seeing myself like this week after week through the game could have been a little bit more embarrassing.
But in all seriousness, make the best of it, right?
Sorry about that. But in all seriousness, though, long before I was a sex therapist, I was just a therapist. And my focus was on treating clients with depression, anxiety, grief, and loss. And I struggled in those early years, as I know many other therapists do, thinking that I somehow needed to like all of my clients, that I needed to be nurturing at all times, and that I needed, that it was always my job somehow to have the answer. Well, luckily, over the years, I've come to accept again that as in therapy, as in life, that's simply not possible. Because we all have limits to our tolerance. We all have people that we don't like. We have personalities we clash with and beliefs we disagree with. We are not always kind and well-spoken, as you'll see in a moment, and we sometimes do not have the answer. We are, in fact, human. In the game, it's no different. We are who we are, good or bad. A great example of that, that I'm going to show you again before we really dive into things, comes from an example of a relationship that I had with a 32-year-old Brazilian woman by the name of Abby Maria Gomez. Those of you who may have watched my season would know that our relationship would probably best be described as contemptuous at best. Our points of view, our life experiences, our philosophies on the game simply did not mesh. The clip I want to show you is very short, but again, it's about being authentic. And the clip came during a time in the game when Abby and I had the pleasure of being stuck on the island together alone, while the rest of our tribe was off enjoying a reward. So I'll go ahead and give you a clip of what being authentic in the game looks like.
We'll make the best of it, right?
Sounds good.
Let's do it.
To make matters worse, I gotta go home with Denise. Denise is like a horrible person, so it's not a fun day. I was really heartbroken, really.
Ugh. It's gonna be a painful afternoon. It's like the first date with the kid who like pulled your hair all the time in kindergarten or like spit in your lunch, and then suddenly you're on a date and it's like, wow, okay, so I'm just gonna make nice.
Oh, Abby, I'm sorry. I know you wanted to go.
I wanted to go so badly.
It's just like, I am literally the swing vote here and I don't think that Michael sees it. It's kind of weird.
It's like, I just want to get to the end of the date. And so I'm going to let her strategize. I'm going to let her talk about how she's a swing vote.
Yeah. You never know what's gonna happen at immunity, you know? You never know who's gonna win.
That's true.
Max Tribal is my last chance to play my idol.
That's true.
She keeps talking about having the hidden immunity idol. None of us believe she has one, not even for a minute. But it's just trying to get through the afternoon and make it as tolerable as it can be.
But anyway, food for thought. Food for thought, for sure.
Hang myself, gouge my eyes out. If I could have like needles that could just go right into my eardrums, I'd be good for the afternoon.
Ugh. Every time I see this clip, I both laugh and I cringe at the same time. I laugh, first of all, because apparently I forgot where my eardrums were. I apparently dropped them down about 12 inches. So, but you know, when I watch that, but I also cringe a little bit because of how absolutely dismissive I was of her. But again, that is what being authentic in the game looks like. It's us being who we are, absolutely unfiltered. Now, being authentic isn't always easy. Sometimes it's truly a struggle to embrace who we truly are, our values, and our beliefs. And again, if I'm completely honest, you know, I have to tell you that a reflection of that struggle is happening right now, right here in this room. Because to be standing here in front of all of you to express who I am and to really own what I believe in was not an easy decision. I worried about the impact that being my authentic self could have on my business as I promoted the event. I worried about the impact on my family as I shared with them my decision to come out here. And even on some of the relationships with some of my close friends. Essentially, being here is a sort of coming out. And it's a little scary, and it could have consequences. But as I made the decision, I got to the point where I told myself, lady, you better practice what you preach. Because how could I, in good faith, tell my clients to stand up for who they are and to own what they believe in if I wasn't willing to do the same thing? So here I am. Thank you. So let's get back to the jungle. In my season of Survivor, there were 18 players. You might remember some of them if you watched. Whoops, I've got to go back to the screen there. There we go. I had a variety of tribe mates in my original tribe at Mount Singh. Some of you may remember Roxy if you watched. Roxy was an evangelical seminary student. And during that season, I observed her and interacted with her as she spoke in tongues on the beach. It was interesting. I'd never seen it before. Then we had Russell in the middle there. And Russell was very clearly strong in his faith and made that quite apparent as he went off on an anger-filled rant that lasted much longer than the 5 minutes which was shown on TV, expressing his anger towards God at our tribe, Mount Singh, losing yet another challenge. And lastly up there, though, we have lovable Zane. Zane was not very outspoken about his faith during my season, but he wore a clear reminder of it on his wrist in a tattoo that's the Serenity Prayer. And only in hindsight after the game have I found out a little bit more about his beliefs. But then we also have Michael Scoopin and Lisa Welchel, both very outspoken, motivational speakers of faith. So going into this, from the very beginning of the application process and the casting process, I'd been very open with CBS about both my specialty in sex therapy and about my religious beliefs. So I knew that if I were cast, the mix of individuals that I would be with would be probably not only quite interesting, but challenging. Because casting is an art form designed to feed storylines and conflict. So being what I believed was a good student of the game, I went in quite prepared with a strategy and guarded. I knew what I needed to do. You know, don't be the bossy mom, don't run with the machete, be helpful at camp, you know, make friends, play nice. You know, the basics of good playground behavior. And I also knew from day one that there would be things I simply would not share with my tribe mates right off the bat, because I knew or I was worried that they would hinder my ability to go deep into the game. This meant withholding certain pieces of who I am, things like my specialty as a sex therapist and my religious beliefs or lack thereof, the very things I've been so open with CBS about. Ultimately, I was telling myself, don't be authentic. And even as I say that standing here, it just feels so wrong because it goes against the core of everything that I do on a daily basis, you know, with clients, with family, and with friends. Because these are two areas of my life that in the right company can lead to some fantastic conversations, but in the wrong mix can end up being a miserable mess. Because both in and out of the game, the reality is that we do make decisions, we do make policies, and we do choose relationships based on likeness, connection, similarity, values, and beliefs. And in the game, as in life, being different can be dangerous. So given that, I never once expected to have happen what did happen. There's another clip that I'm going to show you here next, and it took place on day, I believe it was day 36 in the game. And on this particular day, I had woken up to this extreme stinging sensation on my neck. And it only intensified as the morning went on. As you watch it, I want you to not only pay attention to the clip, but I want you to pay attention to what you feel as you watch this and what your reactions are to it, unfiltered. And after I play it, I'll share with you the rest of the story.
I got up, it was like, like what was that? It was like on fire, like
whatever it is, it's doing something because this is not just sleeping wrong. It's again, it started sharp, burning, like instant, just like burning.
Just stay calm, just breathe just breathe through it.
This morning I got up and as soon as I moved, there's sharp, incredible stinging. It was like my whole neck was on fire right here.
It's just ache and pain, like
this hurts to just even lift my arm or to move my neck. So I don't know if I'm having an allergic reaction to something that bit me.
That could be a poison.
I've got like fang marks somewhere in my neck here, so clearly it wasn't a mosquito.
I'm trying to tell myself to suck it up because you have 3 days left. Like, seriously, if it's just an allergic reaction that'll pass, then we're good.
But I just don't know what it is. I don't know if it was a spider. It could have been a little lizard. There are tarantulas out here. We've seen scorpions. We've seen a snake, you know, going up the tree. You forget that, you know, there's stuff everywhere out here. So I'm just hoping it passes. It's not going to kill me, but it's really, really painful right now.
We're looking to you, Lord.
Just push out whatever poison is in there.
Just make it go through so fast and be completely better. May she feel your arms around her, just rocking her like a baby, like a mother would. It would blow on a wound. You created our bodies, then you know what to do. So we're asking you to relieve this pain and to heal this and make it go away and comfort her in the meantime.
Lord, we have a challenge. We have a big day. We just ask you, Lord, let Denise finish this game.
I feel really bad that Denise is hurt. But when you have an immunity challenge coming up and it's final four, then I'm like kind of relieved a little bit because what scares me the most is freaking Denise winning immunity.
You just ask and heal Denise.
Thank you guys. Oh.
The reality of things are I came here not to be feeling bad for other people. I came here to win $1 million.
Now, I told you I would tell you the rest of the story, and I promise that I will. But before that, I'm curious. I'm truly curious. I'm curious about what you felt as you watched that, what you thought as you watched that. This is your chance, very briefly, in one or two words, if you are so brave, to share with me what your reactions were to that. Is there anyone up in the very front here? In one or two words, because... Straight-faced, how? Projection. You poor thing. Hypocrisy. Sweet but misguided. Disgust. Thank you. Do what it takes to win. What a mix of reactions. For those of you, just because of time, I'll keep going, but for those of you, as you sit there, what I'm curious about, like along with those reactions are, you know, what I wonder is, was it a visceral reaction? Is there nothing? Did it make you angry? Were you appalled? Were you accepting? Because looking around the room as that clip went on, I saw people nodding, the laughter starts, and I can tell there's such a mix of reactions to that clip in the room. For me, being what I would describe as, and some may disagree with how I phrase this, an apathetic agnostic at best, I had a very different experience than you might expect. And it's because of what you didn't see. What you didn't see was a conversation that took place between Lisa Welchel and I days before. In the game, there's a great deal of downtime when you're sitting on the beach, and you can only talk about Twizzlers and nachos so long. So Lisa and I had the opportunity to talk about many different things, her background, her family, even a little bit about marital struggles that were happening for her as she'd had a divorce that had been finalized just days before coming into the game. And so for whatever reason, on one of those occasions, when I was alone with Lisa, I had decided to take a risk. And I struck up a conversation with her that had nothing to do with strategy in the game. I was just curious. What I had said to her was, Lisa, I know you believe, and I'm curious. Help me. Help me understand what it is you feel, what it is you think, what it is you believe, because I've never experienced that. I've never had that feeling or belief. Now, you can imagine out there on the island that there was a small moment of silence before she responded. And during that time, I know that I was bracing. I was bracing for the negativity and fallout that I'd experienced in any other conversation that I'd tried to have like this with any other person in my life. But you know what? It didn't happen. There was no defensiveness. There was no need to brace. It was totally different. What unfolded was a simple conversation with her genuinely expressing her experience of faith and what it meant to her, where it came from, and me sharing my lack of it. We talked about how I've just never felt that pull, how never once have I felt that passion or need, how I just could never grasp that something I could never see or in my mind scientifically validate could possibly exist. And at the end of the conversation, I took away from it was the simple reality that it is what it is. She believes, I don't. It was a moment that was so different for me. Neither of us was trying to convince the other one. There was no defensive guarding. There was no converting or coercing on the other side. We were able to just be curious. Now, maybe that's something that's totally not new to any of you in this room. And maybe that's something that you've had the chance again to experience before. But for me, I never had. And it was meaningful. Because in that moment in the game of Survivor, we were able to be our authentic selves. So, fast forward back to that morning that you saw me get the little bite on my neck there. I was in pain. And I hurt. And what you also didn't see was the moment right before they started praying. When Lisa said to me, Denise, I know you have a different belief, but would it be okay for us to pray over you? And in that moment, I said yes, and I have absolutely no regrets about that. Did it heal me? Of course not. Did I suddenly find God in that moment? No. Did I feel genuinely cared for and connected to them in that moment? Absolutely. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. Just simple human compassion and understanding on both our parts. Now, standing here in front of all of you, I realize that the issue of faith is and religion is an incredibly heated topic, and there's work to do. And I understand that my message may be a little bit different than the ones that you'll hear throughout the weekend. But it really is about change. It's about creating change through an atmosphere of openness, where we don't alienate ourselves from the very people we hope to engage. It's about being curious in order to connect. And for me, it was a place to start. In closing, I just want to highlight a couple of thoughts, because as an atheist community, I truly believe that we can do so much more than just survive. We can thrive. And clearly from those numbers that we saw earlier, that's exactly what's happening. But it's up to each one of us to decide how we can do that that will truly make a difference. So here are just my little survivor thoughts on how we can do that. I truly believe that we can enter into more conversations with more curiosity than contempt. I think of this like when I do therapy in my office. It's about meeting my clients where they're at. If I have someone who is so guarded about their beliefs or so rigid, it's not going to work if I'm the bull in the china shop. So I have to work and be curious and try to understand their point of view and then work to make that shift. I also believe that we can find ways to connect through the differences and not just create more defenses. And we can practice the very tolerance and acceptance that we seek from them. In the words of Mahatma Gandhi, I do believe that we, and it's up to us, to be the change that we wish to see in the world. Thank you all so much. It's a pleasure to be here. And I think they had left a little time for questions, but I want to make sure I'm not doing something out of step. What bit me? We don't know for sure. We think it was a centipede, but you don't have anyone on the island that's watching you 24/7, so we assume that it was a centipede that bit, and they asked one of their island locals that happened to be on the island with us in the background, and he said essentially, we think this is what it is, we don't think you'll die, and it should fade in anywhere in 8 to 24 hours, which was really comforting. So, yeah. There is no doctor with us on the island. There is medical staff available, but you have to travel to go get to that. So I was asked later on if I was okay, but the funny thing is, again, I walked into a tent and they said, Denise, can you stick out your tongue? Can you breathe? And essentially I went off to do, and then off we did it. We did a challenge, so it's really limited. That's never filmed. Let me answer the first question because I'm not sure on the second one. You know, in terms of the praying, I even knew going in, because of my beliefs, I knew that I would likely be paired with a tribe that had someone who had very strong religious beliefs. And clearly I did. I mean, there were, again, Roxy was speaking in tongues, which was just kind of freaky for me. It was just really different. But I even knew going in as a part of my strategy that if they prayed, I was praying. I mean, I wouldn't pray, but I would give the semblance of praying. Just because, again, it's like life. You have to pick and choose. And it would have been dangerous for me, and it would have likely created ripples that would have gotten me out of the game. In terms of anything that's not filmed, there are cameras 24/7. It's all in the editing. I mean, there are cameras from every angle, so there's nothing that they miss, other than me getting bit. But they truly film everything, and it's just what they edit and the storyline that they create. Yeah. Fantastic. And it's also on iTunes. So if you want to see my season, it's also on iTunes or Amazon. So fantastic. It's season number 25, the Philippines. You bet. You know, the reaction, and I'm still, and I hopefully I won't get teary as I... Wow. one little question can change everything. The reaction has been really mixed. It's been, but in a good way. Actually, good and bad. I can tell you the first thing, when I told my brother, who is, there's quite a juxtaposition of things happening this weekend. So I'm here speaking with all of you, and tomorrow my brother is being converted into the Catholic faith. So, if that says anything to you, it's quite a juxtaposition of where things are at. You know, I was raised Methodist, and we went to church every Sunday. My parents were divorced. We didn't go to church at my dad's. But my mom is a very strong believer. My brother is a strong believer, as are his family. And when I mentioned to him that I was coming to this conference or doing it, and I was very hesitant to bring it up, his first words were, "Don't tell mom." And we laugh, but you have no idea the core of what that hit. Because it was, oh, I'm going to get teary. It was all about, don't be yourself.
Oh, thank you. So, woo.
Yeah. So it's all about, it was all about not being yourself. You know, my mother's first words were, shame on you. And they love me. Don't get me wrong, they love me dearly. But being here is a little challenging. For my clients, it's been actually, this is going to be have a ripple effect. You know, I had a conversation with one client in particular, and it was wonderful because her vision of what atheist was demon, like it was demonic. And she felt that, and she was, so we were able to have this authentic conversation in the middle of a session about where I was going and what that meant for me and what faith had meant for her. And I think, you know, just being here and being out a little bit more, it gives me a different empathy for my clients that are coming out for a variety of reasons. I work with a lot of gay and lesbian clients, transgender clients, you know, just making those difficult decisions. So the reaction's been very mixed, but again, I'm being welcomed home with open arms, but definitely we are not of like mind. Oh my gosh, I have lots of questions. So let's see. So, how did their beliefs change at all? I'm not sure if they mean my beliefs or other people's beliefs. So I'm going to flip through that one because I'm not sure. Let's see. Is Jeff Probst an egomaniac? Jeff is a great guy. We don't really get to know Jeff very well during the season. We see him during tribal council, and that's really it. And when I went into the game of Survivor, you know, I went in knowing this is a job, and it's a time-limited job. And I serve a purpose for CBS, and once that purpose is done, I go away, and they're done with me. And I accept that. A lot of players struggle to accept that. So even with that, with getting to know Jeff Probst, I don't really know who he is as a person. I know he's a person of faith, or at least that's what I believe from things that I read and hear from him. I think he's just very, very confident, maybe a little narcissistic, but it makes him really good at his job. Let's see. How did I do my video to get on the show? Oh, I can tell you the first one was horrible, hence why I probably didn't get a call back the first year. I applied 2 years in a row. And the first year I had made this corny video and I included like Mission Impossible music. It was really bad. It was really bad. I have it on my laptop and I just cringe. I click it and I just, ugh. And the second time it was one of those where, again, kind of like I tell my clients, I tell, you know, you have to, if you want to make something happen, you have to work to make it happen. And you have to, you know, face kind of the fear. And it was maybe a day or two before I think the application process was going to close, and I just decided, you know what, if you're going to do it, now's the time to do it. So I came home, I put on my running clothes, because I still wasn't sure if I was going to make the video, and I sat down in front of my computer, and I just started talking. And that's it. I was just me. And I talked a little bit about my career and a little bit about my faith, and or lack thereof, and luck of the draw, I got a call. So, and I'm not sure, somebody, if anyone wants to clarify, I'm not sure if they, again, if they mean my beliefs, or their beliefs. I know in terms of like Michael Scoopin's beliefs and Lisa's beliefs, Roxy and Russell, their beliefs are all very strong and I think fairly unwavering. And you know, I know that's an area of controversy likely to have, you know, a conversation about that here to some extent, but it works for them. And it's kind of like me in therapy again, you know, with clients. I have clients that come in that have, you know, I don't openly say, hey, I'm an atheist therapist, but it comes up in conversation. And again, I work with clients where they're at, and if their faith is important for them, I have to figure out if that can work for them in a healthy way, or you know, when it's not, I have to work to kind of guide through that. Oh, got a few more here. did I get paid? If it means Survivor, I did. I won $1 million. It was a nice paycheck. So I did. I was lucky enough to be the sole survivor. So I'm very lucky that it turned out that way. And thank you very much. And everyone out there, Yao Man is here. I mean, we're out there and you give up so much of your life for 7 weeks. I mean, you sacrifice being away from family and friends and work. And, every one of us would be deserving if you're sitting in that final three or that final two. Somebody said, what is speaking in tongues? Great question. I didn't know. I had only kind of seen it on like little clips. And essentially, Roxy was sitting on the beach, and it was like one of the first days that the sun had come out. And to me, I can only best describe this. She was having her conversation with God, and it sounded like gibberish to me. It was just round like this, it was just very different for me. I'd never seen it. So I wasn't even sure until later that that's what she had been doing. But it was just for her, she felt like she was connecting or communing with God. Any other questions? Oh, all the time. In my season, mental breakdowns, and one, now keep in mind, we all have to be a little crazy to go out there. So it says something about our personalities that we're willing to go out there and put ourselves in that mix. And a variety of, I could get out my DSM, my diagnostic manual, and we could probably diagnose all of us to some extent out there. But, you do, and you see the struggles. For example, Lisa Welchel, again, was so strong in her faith, coming into the game. And for her, being able to get to the end of the game means you're lying, you're manipulating, you're backstabbing, you're doing things that went against the very core of who she was. And you could see her struggle every week through my season. You could see her be happy and then have an absolute breakdown, and then be happy and have an absolute breakdown. And Lisa, I'm trying to think of anybody else in my season. Lisa was the main one that just really struggled because it was just this internal conflict for her. So, yeah, not easy. Any other questions? Oh, they're still bringing them. Okay. Oh, that's it. Okay. Awesome. Thank you very much.